Last week on the podcast, we had a special guest, Mel Daniels, and she was talking all about content marketing. It's been such a massive conversation through my community this week around what is content marketing and how you get to have a plan around your content marketing that I wanted to dedicate a second episode to it. So this is part two of content marketing. Hey, welcome to the Small Business Made Simple podcast, brought to you by socialmediaandmarketing.com.au. Being in business is never easy, but it can be simple, or at least simpler. Join me, your host Jen Donovan, every week where we focus on marketing, social media, and working towards simplifying your business. You with me? Let's do this. Gonna dream it big, 'cause someone out there listening. Everyone's got a voice to give, and it's time I heard you whistling, 'cause there's no point at all. Why, hey there, and welcome to episode 116 of the Small Business Made Simple podcast. Thank you, as always, for lending me your ears today. I know you have lots of choices out there, and I really do appreciate you making me one of them. I am the host, Jen Donovan. I'm a marketing thought leader, digital strategist, and coach for small businesses. And I'm feeling very under the weather today. So I'm pushing through to do this episode for you, but I will have to take some breaks for some water as we go along. I do apologize for the sound of my voice. If you are new to my podcast, I don't normally sound like this, although I think that I sound a little bit sexier than normal. If you're a long-time listener, then super welcome back to you. I hope you can forgive all the flaws that will become part of this podcast as I push through not feeling well. Last week on the podcast, we had Mel Daniels come on, and she was talking to us about content marketing, and it's created quite the conversation in my community. Content marketing is basically coming up with a plan or a strategy around your content that will help you reach your goals. You know, those goals that you set for your business. I really hope that you have some business goals around your business. If not, then that's really a totally different conversation, but 100% something you should be doing. I'm going to move forward on this podcast, assuming that you have set some goals for your business. Setting goals for your business could be as simple as maybe setting or putting down your weekly intentions inside, say, my Facebook group, Like-Minded Business Owners. Every Monday morning, there's a post up there that talks about what are your weekly goals. Maybe if you don't have goals in your business, or you have goals but you struggle to keep yourself accountable to them, maybe start making that a habit. Come into my Like-Minded Business Owners group every Monday and putting down your goals under that goal post, so that other people can see your goals and perhaps help keep you accountable. It will help with your focus for the week and hopefully will get you thinking about your goals more often and, of course, setting business goals. Okay, but back to content. I'm going to assume you have some business goals moving forward. Like I said, this whole conversation around content marketing has created quite a big conversations through my socials and my DMs and my emails this week. There are a lot of people out there that don't have a plan, that don't have a strategy, and are just posting for posting's sake or emailing randomly without a plan, or really just marketing without a plan, basically flying by the seat of their pants, which will work, clearly, for a while, until it won't work anymore. You see, my biggest worry for these people, and if that's you, then my biggest worry for you is that 4 out of 5 business owners fail in the first 5 years. That's 4 out of 5 fail in the first 5 years, and 95% of them are female founders. And if that's not enough to shake your tree, then it should be. Those stats are really, really alarming. But realistically, very few people actually fail in their business. It's more that they burn out. They get so tired trying to get enough people to buy often enough and come back enough times to actually make their business profitable. So they go and get a job. And one of those big pieces of the burnout pie is a lack of marketing strategy. They are flying by the seat of their pants. They're doing the fly by the seat of their pants option. And like I said, it works. but only for a while, until you are so tired of thinking of what to post next or what to email next or what to market next that you start to give up. And you go from being consistent with your marketing to being very inconsistent with your marketing. Let's put it in perspective as a bricks and mortar story. So think of your favorite local store that's open every day and then all of a sudden they're not. They just open when they feel like it. You keep calling at the store. You know, you do this for a while, hoping that they will be open eventually when you've got time to go and see them. But eventually you'll give up and you'll go and start to spend your money elsewhere because it just becomes too hard to do business with them. The same thing will happen if you fail to keep top of mind with your customers or your clients via your marketing. You may not have a bricks and mortar store, but that's not really the point that I'm making. It's more around the fact that you need to be consistent with your marketing. You need to keep showing up for your audience, but we also need to do it in a strategic way so that we don't burn out and we don't give up and go and just get a job. So let's take a bit of a look of what a strategy might look like for you so you don't burn out and so that you can become consistent with your marketing no matter what marketing you are doing. So my first step, step one, you've got to start with your goals. What are your goals for the business? What are your weekly goals, your monthly goals, your yearly goals? What's your five-year plan? And so forth. And this doesn't have to be, you know, as set in stone. Clearly goals shift with business momentum and that's okay. But goals are certainly an important piece of the puzzle when we're talking about content marketing. If you don't know what road to take, any road will do. Think about that. If you don't know what to post, any post will do. If you don't know what to email about, any email will do. I was just speaking to a client the other day who wants to do more speaking. That's one of their goals. They want to do more speaking from the stage. But nowhere in her marketing could I see her using photos of her speaking, telling people that this was one of her skills or asking for gigs. Like, and note the last one, just blatantly asking for the sale. It's such a step that we so often forget. So yes, speaking was a goal, but it wasn't included in her content marketing strategy. And frankly, you can't expect to get too many speaking gigs if no one knows that that's what you want to do or that they don't know that that's a skill that you have. So you can see how important goals are. So what's your goal for the next month? Maybe it's increase your sales by 50%, but how are you going to do that? How are you going to increase your goals, increase your sales by 50%? Maybe you want to increase your email list by 1,000 people this year. And that could be a perfect goal. So like, you know, Jen, I've got a lead magnet. That's amazing. And it solves my ideal client's biggest roadblock. That's perfect. How do people find out about it? It's on my website. Great. How do you get website to your traffic? I'm posting on social media. Fantastic. How many times have you posted about the lead magnet itself? Crickets. It isn't rocket science. It's, you know, but I think that's the problem, that it isn't rocket science. People just overthink what content marketing is. It's the content for your marketing to help you reach your goals. So if you have a goal on your list, look at your marketing, look at your content marketing, past, present, and future. Are you actually posting things or emailing things or marketing that will help you reach those goals? Step two is to start doing some planning. Just plan how you think you should, what works best for you. I'm a colored pens and paper girl, so I print out a calendar from, I just Google, you know, a 2021 calendar, and I start scribbling. But these are some of the things you need to put on that calendar. Your holidays, yep, your time off. Absolutely start there. Start marking off when you aren't available in your business, when you take time off. I feel as so small business owners, we don't mark these things out on our calendar and we're kind of like, oh, we'll just take holidays when it's a little bit quiet. And maybe we never get to the little bit quiet part. So make sure you start by marking the time off that you want inside your business. I take all my school holidays off. I mark it on my calendar so no one can book in during the school holidays. If I want to book someone in, then that's up to me. But people can't randomly go to my Calendly link and book in over school holidays. It's a little thing that I have inside my business. You do you, of course, but you know, it's something I start every year off doing, is marking it off on the calendar. And then we need to mark public holidays and other significant events on your calendar. It's hard to sell a workshop on Easter Monday, for instance. Like, so if you haven't got those basic public holidays put in and any other sort of significant dates in your calendar, then you might mistakenly try and, have the wrong post at the wrong time or be selling the wrong thing at the wrong time. You know, I need to mark these holidays on my calendar because sometimes I don't know when Easter is, or I don't think about things that are coming up like June long weekend and things like that. I just wouldn't know unless I've got it on my calendar. And then you need to start marking relevant events on your calendar. So Father's Day, Mother's Day, Easter, Sydney, Mardi Gras, whatever days are significant in your business. If you sell flowers, then clearly Mother's Day is going to be a pretty important one on your calendar. And then, of course, you need to start putting your own goals on the calendar, your own events, your own workshops, your own promotions. And if we take Mother's Day, for instance, you know, marking Mother's Day on the calendar is only step one. If Mother's Day is a significant day inside your business, as in it's quite a period of high selling, then you need to think about when you need to organize yourself for Mother's Day. So I'm sure that, you know, if you have a gift shop, for instance, you can't be thinking about Mother's Day the week of Mother's Day as you flick over the calendar. You need to be marking it, say, maybe 6 or 8 weeks earlier to go, radio, what do I need to get ready beforehand? What sort of marketing collateral do I need to start building? I need to write email sequences or create web pages or create social assets and so on. And so on. So you need to make sure that if you have a significant event coming up in your business that is, you know, a sale period, then you need to mark it on your calendar 6, 8, 12 weeks beforehand, whatever time frame is appropriate for the event that's coming up, and start working on it. Don't start working on it the week before you actually have to start selling it. Okay, so step three is where your goals come in. You need to start building content ideas around your goals. Some people like to theme their socials or their marketing. In June, for instance, they will have 80% of their posts around a topic around sales mastery. And in July, their topic might be around budgeting for the Christmas buying season and so on. So they're kind of theming each month. Some people even theme each week, depending on how many themes you can come up with in your business. But it just, that might make it easier for you. If you have a theme for each month, that might actually make content marketing a little bit simpler for you. The theme becomes what your blog's about, what your email about, what your social posts are about for the month. Again, perhaps not all of your social posts, but the majority of it. If you blog or podcast weekly, then you're building an enormous amount of content you can repurpose into other channels. I think episode 53 was all about repurposing content. So starting with that one hero piece of content and then how you could repurpose it in all the different ways. I can't remember how many ways there were in episode 53. I think there were 11 or 13. Or something. So that might be worth going back and having a look or having a listen to that podcast as well. If theming doesn't work for you, then let's think about those goals again. If you want to build your list by 1,000 people this year, then you need to come up with something or a few things that people want in exchange for their email address. And you need to make it easy for them to get it as well. So let's stop assuming that because we put something on Facebook last month, that everyone that needed to see it saw it. That's not the way social media works. The same with emails. If you just assume that you put something for sale out in one email and you assume that everybody saw it, then you're not looking at your insights or your analytics around those posts or around those emails. You need to post consistently and often about these things. If list building is your thing, and it should be 100% your thing, by the way, then let's say your goals are 8 speaking gigs for the year, 12 one-to-one private clients for the year. You want to do 15 webinars or workshops for the year. You want to host 3 masterminds for the year, and you want 1,000 people to come through your digital course. So they're your goals for the year, and let's just take note about how specific those goals were. It's not I want more speaking gigs, it's what I want 8 of them, because you have set your goals, you have worked out how much income you would like to earn this year, and you have broken it down into more specific goals. So if you want these goals, for instance, say you want 8 speaking gigs, some of your content will look like testimonials from past speaking gigs, both from hosts and people in your audience, and posts with calls to action for book me as a speaker, pictures of past speaking gigs, posts around, you know, what you're an expert on, like what will you speak about, book me now posts, urgency and scarcity posts as well. If you want more private clients, then again, testimonial posts, book a free discovery call posts, client wins, highlighting clients, client showcasing posts, posts that tap into the biggest challenges, pain points and roadblocks, and of course, sale posts asking for the sale. If you want to host more workshops and webinars, again, you might do testimonial posts, posts around past events, both what people learnt and, you know, who hosted you for those. Posts that tap into biggest challenges and pain points and roadblocks. Highlight the outcomes of attending your workshops or your webinars. Do some sale posts. Do some urgency and scarcity posts and some book now posts. You get the gist. You can see that there are so many things that you can post about. It's just not like, you know, I want more speaking gigs and just putting it out there to the universe. It is strategically thinking about what can I post about? And when I say post, I guess I'm meaning marketing. What can I market about? Because it mightn't just be posts. It might be, you know, radio might be good for you. TV might be good for you. Email marketing might be good for you. Setting up rooms on Clubhouse might be good for you. But it's still going to be tapping into all these different things. Besides those posts, you can also post about your blog or your podcast that you do, posts around lead magnets and freebies that you offer, posts about you, you know, what's your expertise, such as, you know, sharing tips on Tips Tuesday, or even sharing quotes or ideals that really light you up and you know your audience would love to hear from you. Again, that know, like, and trust factor. How many times are you showing up and what are you sharing about you? Not just always about your business. What personality marketing are you doing as well? Now, to be honest, and some of you won't want to hear this, but it's what I see, it is true. It's true that everyone you look at who's smashing it with their marketing does 2 things. They have a hero piece of marketing, of which the majority of their marketing comes from, either a weekly podcast or blog. And if you don't have a weekly podcast or a weekly blog, then why not? Like, if you are worried about the fact that you won't have anything to say, I'm calling BS on that. You are the expert in your field. You know so much about what you are doing inside your business that other people would really love to know. And blogs don't need to be huge. Podcasts don't need to be huge. And in fact, I must admit that I put off doing my podcast for this exact reason. I honestly thought I wouldn't get past about number 27. Before I started my podcast, I brainstormed all the topics that I could think of, and I got to about 23, and I thought, you know what, a couple of guests in there, I'll get to 27. But I started anyway. I was a little bit worried that I wouldn't get past 27, but I thought, well, 27 podcasts are better than none, right? So, you know, if you are scared that you will run out of content, just start. Because if you write 5 blogs, that's better than no blogs. If you do 5 podcasts, it's better than no podcasts. But I guarantee you, once you start, that you will really see that you have so much expertise that people would really love to hear about. And also, people are smashing it, have a plan, they have goals, and they know what direction their marketing is taking you. It might seem like they are just posting things, but they're most likely building trust with you. And trust is really up there for business success, isn't it? Because frankly, we don't buy things from people we don't trust. Okay, so that's content marketing. That's just a little bit extra on from last week talking about content marketing. This week, just digging a little bit deeper for you. I hope this has helped you. My wish for you is that you will sit down and grab a calendar, either print one or do it digitally. You know, you do you, however you can set things, however setting goals works best for you, and start putting in your dates and your goals in the calendar for the remainder of this year. Or if you can't do that, do the next quarter or the next month. Just start. And if you can theme, even if it's just parts of the year, then theme your content. I really think that that will help. Again, if I told you what to cook every night, wouldn't that make your life simpler? Well, that's what a content plan will do for you. It will make your business life simpler. This has been a fabulous conversation and one I think we should keep having for sure. Content is so, so important, and that's why I've put such a big focus on it in my business and also for my private clients. If content is something that you're struggling with, then maybe reach out. I do have free discovery chats available that you can book a call with me and we can go through how I might be able to help you. Just send me a DM on Instagram at Small Business Made Simple or go to my website and book a call. My website, of course, is socialmediaandmarketing.com.au. But that's it for episode 116, all around content marketing. I will be back next Thursday for 117, but I really look forward to connecting with you and chatting in between those episodes as well. If you're enjoying this podcast, then please don't forget to hit the subscribe button, and maybe you could even share this episode with another small business owner who would really love some help with their content marketing as well. But I will see you next week. Have a fabulous week, whoever and whatever it brings. But remember, my small business peeps, as my opening song says, there is no point in dreaming small. Tell like you feel it, say it proud, be true, and let us see you for the star that you are.